Hey, hello, and welcome to the February Comics Experience Graphic Novel Month Club meeting. Hi to all of you on the internet who probably aren't there yet because we started live, and that's just how it works, tech. But hi to you when you watch this later. Our book this month is the lovely and luminous Nightlights by the wonderful Lorena Alvarez, who is right here all the way from Colombia. How cool is that? That's a tremendous distance to come for this, and we appreciate it very, very much.
Thank you.
So this is a great book. This is a fantastic book that everyone loved this, right?
Yeah.
And originally, we had picked it as the Kids Club pick, and I'll tell you guys all the story. Because I sort of threatened it in the email, and I didn't actually tell the story. The pick that we had made for the Adult Club, and I won't tell you who it is, I don't want you to hold it against them. But the writer and the artist for that book declined to come, declined to do a video call with us, declined to do a book plate. They were happy for us to buy 250 copies of their book, but they didn't want to have anything to do with us. And so I said, well, I don't, that's not good. And we decided to make this also the Adult Club pick, which I think really worked, right? Because it's a book that works for both, I think. So that's your backstory for the day. So fantastic book. Now I understand you have a little PDF presentation for us. Do you want to just go straight into that, and then we'll go Q&A?
Okay.
Great. I'm going to hand you the mic then, and Jordan's going to put it up on the screen there.
What are you going to say?
You have no screens.
Yeah,
it'll happen. Do you want to switch seats so you're closer to the screen and you can see better what's happening on the screen?
See yourself for a moment.
So this is me. Oh, okay. Well, this is what I do every day. I'm an illustrator, and I work mostly with children's books and with traditional folk tales. It is a really nice job because I have the opportunity to give a different view of things that have been said over and over. Sometimes I get a little bit bored, and it is always good when I have the opportunity to work with new authors and new projects, new stories. This one, for example, is about a squirrel who has to travel all over the world and solve problems. The author asked me to make her like very adventurous, and the place she wanted her to be was New Zealand. And I had to do a little research about New Zealand, see pictures, read a lot about it, and it was pretty interesting because I feel that being an illustrator makes you learn about a lot of things. This is one of my favorite illustrations for that book. It's a baobab. A baobab is a very big tree. And in the story, it was like a old wise man who had all the secrets of the Maori culture. This one, well, is more traditional. Obviously, you know this, which tale is this, The Wizard of Oz. It is curious because in Colombia it's not that popular. And well, when I was working in this book, I was living in Arkansas, and the landscape was very inspiring. All these huge fields of corn, which were really beautiful, and nature is really important in that story. So I took a lot of what I saw in Arkansas, and it was a really good experience to illustrate this tale. Also the Emerald City, of course. I like to work a lot with color. Color is a very important element in my portfolio, in my art. And well, it's not that I have a very defined palette to work with. I just imagine how the atmosphere should look like, and I work from that. So I think like in a color, in a base color, and I go from it, go on from it. So next. Well, more of the Wizard of Oz. Nature is also very important for me. Biology was in fact my favorite subject at school, and I like to see how things grow, how animals move, and all the process in nature are like really interesting for me. So I try to depict those things in my illustrations too. Next. Well, and I think this is the last one from the book. This is the China town. Well, and it was pretty hard because it was supposed to be like a very fragile world. So when I draw the houses at first, they didn't look fragile enough. So I think it would be a good idea to draw them like pots and cups and all very shiny and with light colors. So next. I also like to make toys. I think that there are a lot of ways to draw, not only taking a pencil and leaving a trace on paper, but also sewing, knitting, drawing a path with your bicycle in the city, and that stuff is another way of drawing, I think. And I really like this process because I can take a 2D image, turn it into a 3D object, and through planning, I do all the cuts, all the patterns, and plan everything, the colors, and it's really a very good process. Next, again, nature is always present in my work. The first one is a sunflower. The second one is a rose, and the third one is a lotus flower. Next. I also learned that you can be an illustrator working in a team. And illustrating is not only drawing or working in your computer, but also things like theater and puppetry. It's also a way to show your point of view. And well, this is very special for me. It's our company, our puppetry company, and all of us are artists or illustrators, animators. Just two of us have acting experience. I don't have any. There's a very good dancer and a theater director, and we do our own puppets. We wrote our stories, and well, it was also a very nice thing because we are all friends and we really care about each other. So it was really nice to rehearse with them and do the presentations. Next. Oh, you can go. Okay. this is a little animation project I did with my husband. We are both illustrators, and he has some experience in animation. And we met this wonderful group, La Magdalena, which has a very interesting proposal, musical proposal, and they do some kind of fusion of Colombian rhythms with modern instruments. Her voice is awesome, and well, this is the video, maybe just a couple of minutes. Oh, well, it's a combination of things. Photoshop for the main character, I designed it, and my husband did the whole animation with After Effects. And he did the also the background. Also, we found this song because my sister-in-law is a cellist. She plays the cello in this song, so we could work closely to the, with our group and everything. So, next. thank you. I also do these kind of things. Little series of drawings using just a black pencil. And well, I just started to think when I started with this series to think about different characters and different stories. A I really love to illustrate, but at some point I feel that I wanted to create my own projects. Next. And I just started to imagine what kind of images or what kind of little stories I wanted to write. And it took a while. I mean, when I started writing comics, it wasn't like a very, well, I wish it was earlier, but I was really intimidated because I was waiting for the biggest story to come out of my head. And it doesn't work like that. I think that starting from a little, it's very important. If you want to tell what happened to you every day, that's a very good idea because you start to train and you start to find different resources to be a good storyteller. Next. So here is the little stories. I like to dance a lot, well, by myself, and so that's me dancing. And the second one was about this guy I met at the bus station. He told me he was part of the Hells Angels, and when he got tired of it, he started to participate in medieval fairs. He was a really nice guy, so he deserved a drawing. Next. And well, it got, I started to work more and more on this. The first strips about, I'm a very lousy driver, and I was supposed to get my driver's license, but I couldn't. And I was trying to find a reason, like to apply myself. But and the second one, well, it's a personal joke of how I know all these singers and groups' names, and I cannot name one single typographer. I'm a graphic designer, and I'm supposed to know that, and I don't. Next. And well, one thing led to another, and I started to think about my education and my personal story. I attended a Catholic school during my entire scholar life, and well, I was I didn't like to talk about it because it wasn't a very good experience. And well, I started to write about it and to draw. And it became a really interesting thing because I started to remember that atmosphere, that really weird atmosphere that we created at school with the stories, all the stories we used to tell each other about the nuns, because we didn't know how they live, what they do after school, if they wear underwear, for example, why could they have under the veil. And they weren't bad, they weren't mean, but they were really weird, and they were for example, they made us look for random verses in the Bible, and that was supposed to be the message of God of the day. And you find these really weird messages like do not allow a sorceress to live. And okay. And next. Yeah, but what did they have under the veil? Next. And I started to I created a workshop for other girls and women who attended Catholic school like me, and it was a pretty good experience because I usually don't do workshops, like illustration workshops, because there are too many and they are very good. And well, I don't like to be in a position of authority, like I know everything and how I'm gonna. I wanted to create instead a space where these girls and women could talk and we could share experiences. So, well, we did this little workshop in 5 days and we tried to emulate in one of the walls in my university the schedule we used to make at school. You have to do it with a red pen and a ruler and write with a cursive letter. And we took photos every day and we put the photos in each one of the days, of course. Next. In the last day, we put together a little exhibition. The goal of the workshop was to create a small art project in 5 days, taking all the things that we talk about, the music we brought, the movies, the text. So, yeah. Some of the art pieces by the participants. Some of them were talk about the uniform as a symbol of getting rid of your identity, for example, and how you start to question your identity, your sexuality, your place in the world while you are at school and dealing with your classmates, with your teachers. Next. And meanwhile, I started to work more and more in my stories. And well, this is one I did in New York during a course in the SBA in the summer. And I found out that it was possible to write and taking little things, little elements from your everyday life. For example, I wrote this story that day because I found this little baby bird dead in the street, which was really sad. Maybe the guy tried to fly and he couldn't. So, yeah. Next. And, well, it is not perfect, but at least I could see that it was possible to finish the story, because sometimes you have this really good idea, a really good beginning, and you start to think about it and it gets so hard to finish it. And that's the hardest part, right? It's not the problem itself, but the solution to that problem. And this is the first pages for Nightlights. But it was really funny because I wasn't planning a book this big. Nightlights was a 6-page story, and well, I finished it and I sent it to Nobro with my portfolio and a little script, a little biography one. And they say, well, we like your story, but it would be a good idea if you take this story and you make it a 54 page book. And I'm like, I didn't know what to do then. I didn't know how to feel. And I was like, well, okay. So I took everything I learned in the workshop with the nuns, with the girls, and it helped me to give a background to the story and a background for the character. Next. So, oh yeah, this is the original Nightlights. This is all the story. The six pages. Next. And well, when I write, it starts like this. I'm a lot of images, a lot of doodles, and scribbles here and there, notes, and I don't. I'm trying to do that now, but I'm not used to write a script or like many writers do. I just start to throw ideas here and there, and then I took them and try to organize them. Next. Oh, this is my character, is Sandy. She kind of looks like me at that age, with the mismatched ponytails. she was, at the beginning, a secondary character in another story, but I really like her, so she became a main character in Nightlights. Next. Well, after I do all those little drawings and those notes, all I take all that and I organize a layout. This is the layout before, just before the coloring. I like to work with a blue pencil because I feel it's easier to the eyes and it's cleaner. I still don't feel like an author. It's weird, but I feel like someone who is still learning how to do these things. I want to think that the next book will be better. Paper. Well, the end of the story, I won't tell you the end, but that was like the idea that could close the entire story, and it was a really good feeling to find it. Well, the places, the backyard, the playground at my school, I'm sorry. And the next one is a trail I used to ride in Arkansas. So the place where Sandy lives is a combination of things, but now it looks a lot like the neighborhoods around Bogota, not downtown, but the neighborhoods around it, which has a lot of green still, and you can go and walk to the river and explore nature a little. Next. And this is my favorite pages. Nightlights comes from a memory I have. When I was very little, at night when it's like really, really dark, I used to imagine like little color dots. I don't know if it is like an optical illusion, maybe, but I used to think that I could catch those dots and play with them. Like drawing with them, I would like start to trace things with my finger. And all the idea of the book came from that memory. And of course, my memories from school and my peers, the nuns. Well, that's it.
Thanks. So, so that's a really interesting journey to me, that you had a 6-page story that they asked you to blow up to 56 pages. I think that's the first time that we've heard that in this. It's interesting. I mean, one of the things that happens here all the time is that every single person has a completely different way of working. You'd be surprised. We've interviewed like 30 people now, and no two of them ever work the same. So if you ever feel like you're not an author, trust me, you are. There's no way, no right or wrong way of working. I'm wondering what it was like to make that step from you had a 6-page story that didn't, upon just glancing at it there, didn't seem like it's this story necessarily.
Oh, well, it's, I think in those 6 pages, that is the heart of the story. Like, the monster is there, and the main problem that I was trying to solve was there, but the character was a little empty then. It was just some random artist who grew up and has to deal with some insecurity.
Right.
But thinking about my school days and talking with other people about it helped me to give meat to my character, and I could talk about her family and the way she interacts with the rest of the world, with her friends, with her teachers, and finally with the monster, which is the most important thing in the book.
Yeah. How difficult was it to move it from that 6 pages to 56 pages?
Well, I still don't know how to apply this. Well, maybe it was changing the time frame, because it is weird. In the 6-page story, it was a bigger frame. It was like years. Mm-hmm. But it was too, like I say, too empty, too shallow. And taking that time frame and making it smaller, like something that could happen in 3 days, gave me the opportunity to work in details, to work in the classrooms and the small dynamics of the everyday life, of school life. Yeah, so it was like, okay, let's take it easy and let's see what happens each hour almost.
Right.
Yeah.
Did you hit a point where you're like, okay, I've got it up to 50 pages. I've got to come up with 6 more pages. Or
of course.
Yeah? Okay.
That's when the illustrator comes forward. And I say, okay, I have all these pages. I also have the opportunity to create really good images that I couldn't do before.
Sure.
So, yeah, I took the opportunity and I say, okay, let's do these four pages. And these double pages with a lot of things and all the details. Yeah.
So why was it? Well, actually, I guess there's two questions. Right? Was No Brow the only place that you'd submitted to?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And so then why No Brow? Why them of all publishers?
I found this book by Luke Pearson. Not Ilda. It was one, I think, the things we lost. I can't. Mm-hmm, yeah, in the library, and I just fell in love with that book, and I felt also that the No Brow was very respectful with the author. They let the author to come out with this idea, and the drawings and the text were like really intimate, like very sincere, and I really like that. And I also like the care on the books, on the bookmaking, the printing, and well, the object. So yeah, they were my first option.
Nice. Yeah. It's really nice to be accepted by the first thing that you. And in fact, I'm speaking of the printing. I not all of you have seen this, but here, this is the book plate that so Lorena didn't want to mail these because she was afraid that coming from Colombia that they'd get intercepted and destroyed because people, you know, send drugs and things through the mail. And so she signed these all here today. This is, I think, the nicest quality book plate we've had yet. It is on really thick stock, and it's gorgeous and beautiful, and this thing's fantastic. So if you haven't already gotten one, Doug will make sure you get one before the end of the night. We have plenty of them. Well, let me back up, actually. Let me back up. We were talking a little earlier about the comics industry in Colombia, and it seems to me that it's kind of similar to what comics were in America, like back in the 80s, where there was not a cultural acceptance of comics. That there were people who were trying to do stuff, but it really wasn't necessarily very organized or anything like that. So in that background, what was it that attracted you to comics, as opposed to just illustration, but like, you know, the telling a story through pictures?
Oh, well, the idea of being able to tell something, of course. And well, comics back then in the 90s was a really underground thing. It's not that they weren't people doing comics. Instead, there were a lot of people doing comics, but it wasn't in the big publishing area. It was more a small press, a lot of small press, and it was organized, but in small clusters in different cities. And well, it was really interesting because it was something that circulated a lot in high school, for example. Mm-hmm. And you could start drawing some humor pages and sharing it with your friends. And well, when I got into college, I abandoned that a little because it was a really intimidating thing to go there and say, okay, I can draw. And it was also because I had this idea that comic books were mostly for guys, for men. Mm. I didn't meet any female authors then until very recently, in fact. And well, I was very shy about it. Yeah, I became an illustrator. I love being an illustrator, but it was also really nice to find out that I could also write my own stories. Yeah. So it was a kind of self-discovery too. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then you came to the United States with your husband. Uh-huh. Because he...
Oh yeah, he got a Fulbright scholarship. Oh,
Fulbright scholarship. Wow, yeah. That's really impressive. Yeah. That's really impressive. And then you said you went to SVA. So kind of walk us through, like, how did you find out? The SVA is the School of Visual Arts, for those of you who don't know. How did you find out about the School of Visual Arts, and then what led you to go to New York and do that?
Oh, well, we always had this idea of going to New York to do some workshop or something, because we like to talk about the academic tourism. And I started to look for short programs. And I found this illustration and visual storytelling program, I guess, in SVA. And I found out that it was all about the experience of being in New York and sharing with people from all over the world and drawing what you like. And at the end, it would be a little exhibition. And we say, well, go for it. And so we saved some money. And we applied and we got accepted, and it was a really good experience being there, and not only as tourists but also as people who are living in New York and observing and taking notes and drawing life. It was really cool.
And did that help sort of magnify the interest in comics? Is that?
Yeah, actually it does. There was this little course with Paul Hope, and he made us write comics in a very short time, like 45 minutes or 30 minutes. and you had to make these assignments, like going out and take notes and drawing people you see, drawing places, and the next day you have to write a comic about it in a very short time. So maybe the pressure helped. And I realized that, as I said before, that I could finish a story. And it was a very good impulse to start doing my own stories, my own things.
Very nice. I want to open it up if there's any questions from the audience. And also, if there's anyone on the internet who's watching who has a question, don't forget to submit them, and we'll get them asked as well. But
I see a hand in the audience, so I'm going to hand the mic back.
Cool. Hi there. So this is going to sound very random, but I don't know if you watched Pokemon at all or were interested in that ever, but a lot of your creatures reminded me of Pokemon, both just like in the cuteness, but also in the way that you played with the elements and things like that and incorporating aspects of them. And I just thought it was really cool. I was just wondering if that cartoon or any cartoons like that influenced you.
Of course. I mean, when I was at school, I used to watch a lot of anime. It is quite popular in Colombia, actually. And all this idea of character design, since I really like biology, I really like to combine elements from here and there, vegetables and animals and fungi. And make like my own character. So yeah, of course, I really liked Pokemon.
Another question?
I'm curious, in your work illustrating folk tales and things like that, what your favorite one to work on was, and what about it you loved?
I should say The Wizard of Oz was my favorite project. Yeah, I had enough time to think about it, and it was a new story for me. That was very important, that I really liked reading the book. I didn't know much about it. I saw some the movie, but like I said, in Colombia it's not that popular, so illustrating that book while I was living here was a really good experience. So I learned a lot, which is the most important thing, I guess.
Were you reading the original BOM, or were you doing it from a Spanish translation, or?
No, it was in English, the original unabridged book. Uh-huh, yeah. Uh-huh.
It's interesting because I read BOM now and it feels so stilted, his language. You probably wouldn't notice, but because it was written, you know, 1901 or something like that. It some of the language there is really strange. And so actually that brings me to the other thing that you said earlier that kind of blew my mind, was that you wrote this book in English rather than your native Spanish. So was that a challenge?
Well, I'd write better than I speak.
Oh, and you speak fine. I wasn't trying to insult you there.
Like. No. Well, with some idioms, because I still wanted it to feel like we were talking in Colombia, like the way we treat each other. So yeah, that was the hardest part. But Nobra knew about it, so they helped me. With some grammar and with some slang.
Interesting.
For the Wizard of Oz book, what were those drawings used for? Are they available? Can I go buy them? Where?
It was published in the UK by Osborne, which is a really good publishing house. And I don't know, I think they brought it here, but Osborne, The Wizard of Oz, that's the book.
Do you have any interest in doing any of the other books in the series? I mean, there's like 25 of them or something.
Oh, you mean like other tales?
Yeah, well, because there's not just the Wizard of Oz, but then there's Dorothy of Oz, and there's the Emerald City of Oz. And...
Oh, okay. No, just the Wizard of Oz. Yeah. Well, with Osborne, for example, all the classic tales, which is really fun because, I can give like a different point of view, but sometimes you have to do it like twice. And okay, how can I illustrate Little Red Riding Hood again?
Right.
So yeah.
So it looks like it looked to me like you don't have a formal script process, that you're just sort of doodling and then you lay the book out. Is that is that right?
Yeah.
That's great. That's fascinating. Cause...
Now I'm trying to keep two sketchbooks,
mm-hmm.
one with the drawings and mm-hmm. another one with the text.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I try to keep these very separate, and I'm working more on my dialogues.
Mm-hmm.
Which is helping me a lot because I don't like writing, okay, this happens first, then this, but writing how the characters interact with each other, I think it's helpful for
mm-hmm.
me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. When you do the blue lines, the pencils,
mm-hmm.
Are you doing that on Bristol board or on paper, or are you doing it in the computer?
No, I do that. In a big sketchbook.
Mm-hmm, yeah. Mm-hmm. And then you scan the pages in. Yeah. But you do your color digitally.
Yeah, inks and color digitally.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So how long does a page take you?
Oh, if I draw it and ink it and color it all at once, it would be like 2 or 3 days, maybe
mm-hmm,
4.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And well, asleep in a minute.
Sure, sure, sure.
Yeah.
So to do Nightlights, 8 months? Is that about right?
Yeah, the final part. Yeah, uh-huh. It was like 9 months.
9 months, uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's
almost
like a baby.
Yeah. And she's beautiful. what were the challenges of coming up with I mean, there's a darkness to this book, right? And there's a scariness to this book that I actually think is one of the greatest things about it. It was because clearly it's light and it's luminous and it's dark. So I mean, can you talk about that at all, or was that a stupid question?
It was something I did without realizing.
Mm.
When the book got published and people started to write about it. They used a lot the word creepy, and I couldn't understand why. Not because creepy was a bad word or something, but I didn't plan it that way. And when I took a second look at it, I could understand why, but still, I mean, being a child is not always like ribbons and ponies and stuff, but it's also being afraid of things. And I remember that very clearly. I wanted to be respectful to the readers. If they are adults or children, I didn't want to be condescending. That's the only thing I had clear in my mind, to be respectful and to understand that you can be afraid at any age. Yeah.
Did you have an ideal reader in mind? Were you thinking that this is for kids or this is for me when I was a kid, or?
Oh, not really. I just thought, okay, this is a story, and mm-hmm. to whoever who wants to read it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I didn't think on a specific public. Mm-hmm. No.
Yeah. That's probably why I find it so universal and appealing too.
So, your the animation that you showed us was beautiful, Hagamos Temblar, and I was just curious, if you've dived into doing other animations or you're interested in doing more animations of your work, just because I think it's like the, in my eyes, when I was reading it, I imagined it in my head as an animation going by, and these were just the still frames that you were showing us.
Well, I've done some character design and backgrounds and, well, projects like this. This is the first one. We had the idea of making more music videos. We really like the process, so we want to make more. But for now, I like to participate in small roles, like drawing a character, helping with backgrounds, with some concept art.
I also imagine that doing an animation project like that takes considerably more time.
Yeah. And it was a very small team. It was me and my husband and some friends who helped us with the 3D modeling and some frames. But we did it because we really liked the song, and we thought it could be a really good idea to make a video with it. So it's a very, it's a personal project too. We didn't think of it on terms of selling it or something like that. Yeah.
How long did it take?
Oh, I can't remember. It was like 5 months.
Okay.
Yeah.
For 6 minutes or so, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. A month, a minute. Wow. Animation's crazy.
Yeah, and well, After Effects is a really great program, and you could make a lot of time.
Yeah.
It helps a lot.
Sure, absolutely.
Sorry, my arms are short. So you mentioned the puppetry troupe that you had, and I was curious if there was any way in particular that you noticed that influenced your other illustration, or even if it helped you with Nightlights.
Oh, yes. I think the idea of a choreography, of putting all the elements together in a harmonical composition, helped a lot in the theater. And doing that in a physical way, I mean, like being there and have to be with your partner here and another one there and moving all these dolls, helps you to understand how that would look like in an image. Because the goal with that project, with the puppetry group, was to create images, movement, and we always had to be in the right place at the right time. And I think it works the same way with an illustration or with a comic. Yeah, how to choose the frames and the composition works in a very similar way now that I think about it.
Interesting. Nightlights is available in the United States and the UK. Yes. And you said that there was an Italian edition.
Yeah, there will be an Italian edition.
French
and Spanish.
And Spanish, yeah. Okay. So is the Spanish out yet?
Not yet.
So the book's not even available in Colombia now?
No. Yeah, that's
is that a strange experience, knowing that here you are, an author doing internationally touring for a book. And
yeah, that's weird. And I wish it could be made. I don't know. I just went with the circumstances. Yeah. And it would be really cool if it were published in Colombia. Maybe it's an option to make a special edition for Colombia. That would be nice.
Yeah. Well, particularly because you were saying that you didn't have any other female cartoonist role models, and so.
Well, now I have, in Colombia, but but then, well, I just choose Nobra. I say, okay, I really like this publishing house, and I was living Arkansas and everything, so Yeah, it's not like I didn't want it to get it published in Colombia. On the contrary, but yeah, I think it's just the circumstances.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
I find it fascinating. That's all. are you? Oh, sorry, Sarah. How's it going?
Just on the note of it being translated into other languages, did you translate the Spanish edition yourself, or did you have a translator?
So yeah, I'm very curious about it.
Oh, you haven't even seen the translation yet? Oh wow!
I did the title. Uh-huh. It's called Luces Nocturnas.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, it's gonna be interesting.
You're gonna have to run forward though, because I'm not gonna run the mic all the way back.
So I wanted to ask you about you. You have an interest in drawing in non-photo. Is that non-photo blue? Did that come from your history as a graphic designer? Did you learn that in school, or what's the genesis of that interest? You do your pages. Is it non-photo blue, or did you just work in blue pencil because it's a subtle?
I saw that in some sketchbook from a really good artist. I can't remember who, but I could notice that it was really easy to work with these kind of pencils. Not because of a very technical reason, but because I feel that they are cleaner than the graphite pencil, because it is smudges. Yeah, and the blue ones are more greasy, and it holds better. And I think it's easier to the eyes, it's more relaxing, and you feel like you don't have to erase a lot and do a lot of corrections. Yeah, it's easy.
You keep the looseness of all the lines.
Yeah, uh-huh.
What's the editorial process on, like, on a book like this? Are you, as you do each page, are you sending them into Nobrow? Are you sending them 20 pages at a time? Did you just wait until the whole thing was done and go, okay, what do you think?
No, it was like, okay, I had these pages and I feel like it was time to talk and share things. So I contacted the editor and we take a time to talk through Skype or through email. And, well, they were very respectful with my process. They never pressured me to do anything I didn't want to. And the only suggestion they made was about Sandy's age, to make her a little bit older. She was younger in the first version. That was it. But they were really open to hear my ideas. And well, at the same time that I was showing my pages, I had to write a script, like a really detailed technical script, page by page and frame by frame. And but yeah, they were like really open about it. Yeah, they didn't make a lot of suggestions, and that was really good.
Okay. Were there any issues, since this was your first script, once you were approached the scripting stage, of how many pages, how many words per page, how many words per balloon?
Well, it was like a very organic process, because I always draw and at the same time I take notes and I write sentences and little bits of dialogue. So in some pages I had that problem. I was like, okay, where I'm going to put this balloon? Because I had the drawing ready but not the text. But eventually I could find a way. Yeah.
Very good. Anything else from the room? Yes.
I was just wondering a little about the names of the characters, because I was reading it and I was struck by the fact that there was Morphe, and I was wondering about the origin of the name. I was thinking actually Morpheus, the god of dreams, and then I thought about, well, Sandy, maybe that's to do with the Sandman character and from mythology and all that. And then I was wondering, okay, are there any other significant names in it? Just they all seemed like so many interesting names. So.
Oh, yeah. Oh, well, Sandy, behind Sandy's name, there's not much to talk about. Sandy is Sandy because she was a secondary character in another story. And she was always, in that story, eating a sandwich. Oh, so yeah, great. The next time I'm going to say the Sandman or something to look more.
That's great.
And Morphe, it's because this character can take different forms, and yeah, it's more like a Spanish root. Well, a Latin,
root. Yeah, metamorphosis. That's awesome. Are you what? You can ask one more question. You can ask five more questions. So, oh, wait, get on the mic so that it's on so it's on the recording.
Where are they? That's 1 second. I had the pages.
These flipping pages.
So the big pages like this. The big pages like the really big ones.
Full page.
Yeah, the full page. I need one. Where are they?
Yeah.
The big pages. Had you ever drawn anything like those before you did them? Had you ever done anything that was darker on the edges and bright on the inside? Was that your first time? How did you? It's so beautiful. It's so absurdly beautiful.
Well, that's when the illustrator comes forward. And yeah, like I said, I had all these pages to fill. And
but have you ever drawn that before?
Oh, well, I really like to create a strong contrast with the colors and the backgrounds. Yeah, so yeah, the dark backgrounds are common in some of my pieces. But in this book, I had the opportunity to draw things that I couldn't draw before. So, yeah. So yeah, it was the first time also.
So I know this wasn't your first time doing something for print, but I've also done some color work for print, and it's always interesting to see how it changes from your screen to the printed page. Was there anything that surprised you or anything of note when you saw it in print, color-wise?
Well, it is always hard to work with these dark, rich colors like purple and green, for example. But I think Navra take good note of that, and they showed me the proofs, and they took all my suggestions, and I'm really happy with the result. Yeah, it is. It is always, you have to expect some changes because the screen works in a completely different way from the print, but this was pretty close to what I wanted.
Were there parts that you, when you got the proof back, you went, oh, I need to lighten it up, I need to darken it down, or did you just go with what it was?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I really like it. Yeah.
No, I mean, the reproduction is fantastic, as far as I can tell. Not that I can see the original artwork, but it's so beautiful. It's so beautiful. So beautiful. Thanks. Yeah, no, and I think you're right. I mean, it's interesting because it has such a dark palette in so many places, which makes all the light parts pop even greater. What's the font? Is that...
Oh, I don't know its name. The designer who made it, she was very careful too with it. I think she really did a great job putting these together.
You know, it's really, I usually don't like computer font, mm-hmm. but I think it is very organic, and it and it looks very, very beautiful here.
Yeah, I'm really happy with it.
Yeah. So I think my next obvious question would be, what's next? You have another book you're working on? Please tell us. Yes.
Yes. I'm working in the second book, actually. I think it's harder than the first one for some reason. And yeah, I really want to become a better writer and to be able to carry bigger projects and someday be able to do like a on-run story, like a continuous story, mm-hmm. or a bigger graphic novel, mm-hmm. and to explore different topics. Yeah, that's.
Can you give us any hints as what your next work is going to be?
No.
No? We're like 50-50 on that question. You know, sometimes we're like, yeah, no, I want to give you a good hint. You know.
Yeah, I don't like to talk much.
Sure,
about
sure, absolutely.
Projects. Yeah. Not because of contracts or stuff like that, because I feel it is better to keep it very close to you. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is it tonally like this work, or is it something completely different?
I think it will take elements from this book, of course, but I want to explore a different theme.
Yeah. Awesome. Anyone else got another question of any kind?
Just a little anecdote, which is I read this last weekend, and I finished it on Monday, which was 3/14, which is 5 days.
Originally I had asked her to come last weekend, but then I realized it was daylight savings time and it would have been stupid. And then after I said it was going to be stupid, then I went, oh, but it's Pi Day.
It's Pi Day.
Ugh, you know, so mess that one up both directions. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, thanks.
So you mentioned that the world that you built in this story is kind of based on Bogota, but also based on Arkansas and other places. I'd just love to hear more about that. In my mind, when I first saw it, I was thinking it was kind of like Japan or like a fictional Asian city or something like that. So it's really interesting.
I thought a lot about the neighborhood I grew up in. For example, there are this scene when she's riding her bike with the neighborhood stores and all the people around the buses. And I really like that of my city. I mean, the fact that you can find everything anytime. And the movement also. And the idea of nature came from Arkansas. Like, I really like the bike trail and the summer. Yeah, all the trees and the flowers that are in the season, and well, it blend together. But when I finished the book, it started to look like these neighborhoods that are far from downtown in Bogota, like the one I used to live in, and with a lot of green. Bogota is a very, it's a city, it's a big city, but it also has a lot of green. It is surrounded by mountains, and it is easy to go to the river and do trekking and all the stuff very near, I mean. And I wanted to bring that on my book, and I hope that in the next one that will be more evident. In fact,
Morphe kind of wants to absorb mm-hmm. her art, to eat it, to. And I'm wondering, is that a fear that you have yourself that when you I don't even know how to phrase that actually necessarily.
Okay. I think a lot about how the things that you love become your job, which is it is really nice to do what you love as a job, but it also has many traps. And I was thinking about the insecurities it brings when you have to depend on your art to eat and to do your life. And also how to deal not only with criticism, but with praising, with appraisal, which is also like a very, it can limit you. It can constrain you.
Sure.
It can be like a straitjacket in some way, because it pressures you to do the same thing over and over. And at some point you could lose your authenticity and you're willing to do your own projects, your own ideas, just to please others. So yeah, that's a very very real fear I have.
Yeah, I can see that. Well, let's hope that it doesn't come to that, because you're fantastic, and I want to see more from you, and I want to see whatever it is that you want to do. I was really in awe of this when I read this book, and you know, because we get the review copies from publishers, and most of the time the books aren't nearly as good as they look in the catalog, you know. And this was one of the rare ones that I read it and I was just the whole time. So I don't mean to put a straitjacket on you with praise. So don't take that personally. But it's a fantastic book, and we want to see more from you, I think. And
fresh take on it.
Yeah, very much so. Very much so. I want to thank you for coming out and talking to us. I want to thank you for this book. I it's very powerful stuff. And yeah. I also want to remind everybody that the next event we have is Michael DeForge for Styx Angelica, which you should have all gotten or you're going to get tonight, which is the March book. And Michael DeForge is going to be here live and in person on April 5th at 6 p.m. for signing and 8 p.m. for the thing. He's a visionary creator who's pretty amazing, and so I really hope we all get you to come back out as well, and I'm sure you'll have lots of really great questions for him. I want to thank everybody once again for coming out. I want to thank you so much for coming all the way from Colombia. That's kind of amazing to me, and I want to thank you really from my heart for this book, because this I thought was a special book, and yeah, so thank you so much. Very good. Okay, well, thank you, the studio audience at home. We will see you next time, and keep reading more comics, okay?